This is you. You were born to run. When it started, you knew where the finish line was, and you knew you had what it would take to succeed. You knew it would be hard, and it would take everything you have. Your enthusiasm had no end, and your dreams were limitless. The very thought of reaching the finish line energized you, but then it happened. Fatigue set in. The vision seemed to get further away. Being in the lead was at first inspiring, but now it feels lonely. Then the questions crept into your mind. Am I really out in front? Or did I just take a wrong turn? So here you are. Are you running for the sake of it? Or is there a deeper purpose? Then you remember. You were born to run. You can't just stop. Because something greater calls you forward. The only thing worse than fatigue would be giving up the race. The experience you've had is not how it's supposed to be. You were made to be united, to pull each other to victory. You were born to run.
So I don't know about you, I find that very inspiring, but I also have to admit to you, I don't know that I was born to run. I was born to walk and kind of stroll, but I don't know that I've ever dreamed in my wildest dreams that I was born to run. But born to eat, I go, yeah, that's kind of what I was born for. So, but all of us are born for a purpose. There's a reason for our existence. And so next week, we can begin a new series entitled The Purpose-Driven Life as we try to figure out, okay, God, what did you create us to do? And if it's not running, and hopefully it's more than eating, then what did you create me to do? What's my purpose in life as we move forward? Now, the cool thing about the new year is that it gives us a chance to kind of reflect and say, okay, where are we? And one of the things that I do connect with in that video is the fact that wrong turns are something that are common in life, and they're common in my life, where I go, I realize, okay, somehow I've made a wrong turn here. I've gotten off course, and I need to make corrections, and the new year is a time that allows us to make corrections. Sometimes we call them New Year's resolutions. Some of you may make New Year's resolutions. Not something that I've ever been a big fan of. Maybe it's just the rebel in me and everybody else does them, so I don't want to do them. Maybe it's because they usually involve exercise and diet, and that doesn't sit well with me. But for whatever reason, New Year's resolutions have never been a big thing for me. But I want to challenge us today to consider doing something for this next year that I think can have a huge impact in all of our lives. I want to challenge each of us, myself included, to begin to do something that throughout this year, if we will do this, then I think it has the capacity to change each of our lives. Am I still on here? What I want to challenge us to do is to actually use three words that aren't common to our vocabulary, at least not in this set of phrase of three words. Three words that I think if we will use the words, have the opportunity, the capacity to actually change our lives. Now, there's a lot of three word phrases, three word groupings that we use all the time that don't really have any capacity to change our lives. I just kind of thought through some of those words. How much farther? You know, when you're traveling, how much farther do I have to go? That's enough. I'm done. I've had enough. One more bite. And it's interesting the inflections on how we have say these words. They make different things. Does this fit? It would be another phrase. Where's my car? You did what? Please don't go. I'm so tired. Again, phrases that may not be life-changing for us, but where's the remote? Now, this one is life-changing as I think through that one. What was that? Let's go home. Time to go home. Who was that or who is that? Who is that? Where are you? How's it going? How much longer? Are we about done yet? What's the cost? How much is this going to cost me? Time for bed. Where's my phone? Which I find that one a lot. What's the matter? Just in time. Are you okay? All of these are phrases. We use three-word phrases, but they're not necessarily life-changing phrases. Now, a couple other phrases that start getting closer to being life-changing. I love you, which sometimes we struggle to say. I am sorry, which oftentimes we struggle a great deal to say. And then the last one is one Super Bowl champs, which I know Eagle fans can't even say it. Those of you that love the Eagles have never had opportunity to say that kind of three-word phrase, and who knows, maybe in the future, but Super Bowl champs. So that would be one phrase, but that's not even the phrase that I'm talking about, though that would be life-changing for some of you to be able to say that phrase. But the three-word phrase that I want to challenge us to use this year that I think could be life-changing for us is actually the phrase, I was wrong. It's a phrase that I hate to use. It just infuriates me to have to use it. And yet it's one that I oftentimes, at least if I don't always say it, I should say it more often than not. I was wrong. Now, I don't know why it's so hard for us to use this phrase, but it's been one that's been hard for people to use throughout history. From the beginning of time, it's been difficult for people to say. Let me ask you to grab a Bible, open it up to Genesis chapter 3, and I just want you to see how this struggle to use this particular phrase has gone on from the beginning of time. If you don't have a Bible with you, there's some in the seats there around you. Genesis chapter 4. And I want to read to you a conversation that took place between God himself and Adam and Eve. Genesis chapter 3, actually, page 4. And I'll begin reading in verse 1. This conversation that took place between God and Adam and Eve. It says, "The serpent was the shrewdest of all wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the women, 'Did God really say to you, you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?' 'Of course we may eat from fruit of the trees of the garden,' the woman replied. 'It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat or even touch it. If you do, you will die.'" Now let me stop here and just tell you something about God. One of the things that I love and appreciate about God is God does not force himself on us. He gives us opportunity. He always gives us choice, and he easily could. He could force us and make us like robots where we have no choice as to how we live our lives, but he gives us opportunities. He gives us choices. And one of the things you need to know about God is God is a gentleman. He doesn't force his way on us. And so even as we read this story, God gives instructions. He says, look, you can eat anything that you want. There's just one tree that I'm going to ask you not to eat. Don't touch it. One tree, but it's your choice. It's your call. So we go on in the story of verse 4. The serpent says, "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat it, and you'll be like God, knowing both good and evil." Up to that point, they were in a perfect world. Up until that point, they only knew good. The woman was convinced. She saw the tree was beautiful and it looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her, so she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness, so they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. So they eat from the tree they were told not to, their choice, their call. All of a sudden, they see everything, not just good, but they see evil. And so this is what happens, verse 8. "When the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking about in the garden. So they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Then the Lord God called to the man, 'Where are you?' He replied, 'I heard you walking in the garden, so I hid. I was afraid because I was naked.' 'Who told you that you were naked?' the Lord God asked. 'Have you eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat?' The man replied, 'It was the woman who gave me the fruit, and I ate it.' Then the Lord God asked the woman, 'What have you done?' 'The serpent deceived me,' she replied. 'That's why I ate it.'" Now, right off the bat, and it's like from the beginning of time, it's just built into us. We're wired for it. Blame somebody else. Pass the buck, blame somebody else. Not my fault. I'm not the one that actually is guilty for doing this. And so as we look at what the woman and the man actually says, he says, look, it was the woman that you gave me, first of all. So God, you know, you gave her to me. It's the woman. It's her fault, but you gave me the woman. I didn't want her. I didn't ask for her. I was okay. Me, just the animals, I was okay. And I appreciate her. She's beautiful. She's cute. I love the company. But you are the one, God, that gave her to me. And right off the bat, rather than Adam or Eve saying, you know what, I was wrong, right off the bat, they begin blaming other people. And it just kind of happens from now on. Where each and every one of us, we refuse to admit that we're wrong. We refuse to admit that we've gotten off track. We would never want to say, oh, we're the ones, we're guilty, we've done the wrong thing. Instead, we're constantly trying to blame others, always afraid to say the words, I was wrong. Here's what I want us to understand. As we talk about the new year, as we talk about wanting to make changes in each of our lives during the new year, the first step to change is to admit what we're currently doing is wrong. If there's anything in our lives that we want to be different, then the very first step to change is admitting, you know what, the way I'm going, it's wrong. What I'm doing right now in my life, it's not the right direction. It's not the right way for me to be going. If I want this year to be different for me, let's say I want it to be different at home, different between you and your kids, different between you and your wife or you and your husband, then at some point you gotta say, you know what I'm doing, it's not working. I was wrong in the way I've been handling things, and so I'm gonna have to make changes. But it all starts with I was wrong. Different between you and your boss. You want it to be different between you and your coworkers. You say, if things could just be different at work, then at some point you gotta say, okay, what I've been doing, I was wrong, it's not working. And I'm gonna have to make changes. Or if you say, you know what, I just want it to be different between me and God. And somehow you feel like you're at odds with God, then it's stepping back and saying, okay, whatever it is that I'm doing, it's not working. I've gotta step back and just admit that I am wrong. And are you tired of financial stress? You say, you know what, the stress of my finances, it's just overwhelming to me. First step is saying, you know what, okay, my current habits, they're not working. Whatever I'm doing right now, it's not working. I was wrong in how I thought to do this. I know for myself, when Ruth and I are at odds, the first step in correcting it is for me to step back and say, okay, somewhere in here I was wrong. What I was thinking, what I was doing, what I was saying, the way I was behaving, I was wrong. And that's my first step. My first step in my relationship with Jesus, if I feel like, you know what, there's a strain, there's a chasm there, my first step is always to say, you know what, I'm heading in the wrong direction. I was wrong. And somehow I need to make a change. Now, Jesus was always criticized for hanging out with the wrong crowd. Jesus was always, when he walked the earth, criticized for hanging out people that had lots and lots of issues, people that didn't have their lives together, the people that had taken many, many wrong turns in their life, people like us, people who had making wrong turns in their lives, and so somehow their reputation had become stained, the direction they were going wasn't working out so well, and somehow these were people that didn't have it all together, and these are the people that Jesus typically would hang out with. For some reason, they loved hanging out with him, and he loved hanging out with them. I would say to you, if you had happened to have been alive at that time and you'd had the opportunity to hang out with Jesus, you would have liked hanging out with him. He would have loved hanging out with you. But the religious people of his day got all upset about this. They didn't like it at all. And so they were constantly saying, why do you do this, Jesus? Why do you hang out with these kind of people? What they actually said in one particular story is, why do you eat and drink with such scum? People that have made wrong turns, people that don't have their lives all together. Jesus, why in the world do you do this? And Jesus' response is just really kind of interesting. He said, I'll tell you why I hang out with this type of people. He said, this is the reason why I hang out with them. Healthy people don't need a doctor, sick people do. He said, I've come not for people that think they're healthy, but sick people. He goes on, he says, I've come to call not those who think they're righteous, who think they're on the right path, think they're doing the right things, but those who know that they are sinners and need to repent. Jesus said, my whole reason for coming into the world is not to be with people that think they've got it all together. If you think you've got it all together, if you think you're righteous, is the word that he uses, I'm not for you. You don't need me. You don't think you need me. You think you're on the right road. You don't think you've done anything wrong. The people he said that I'm here for, the people that I'm wanting to hang out with, are the people that know that they've done wrong. I was wrong. So Jesus uses the word sinners. He uses the word sinners that know they need to repent. To repent is just to turn around. To repent is just change directions. And we only change directions when we know that we're wrong. The way we're going is wrong. I was wrong. I need to change directions. And Jesus says, look, that's the whole reason that I've come. People that know that they need to change directions. And so really, if we were to rephrase what Jesus said, he said, I've come for people that I've come not for those that think they are right, but those who know they are wrong and know that they need to change directions. Jesus said, that's why I'm here. People that are willing to say, I'm wrong. I was wrong. And so here's my challenge for us as we go into the new year. What if we changed our attitudes? Instead of always presenting ourselves as being right, instead of always thinking we're the ones that know the right direction to go, somehow we know better than others, we know better than God, what if we were to step back and begin to develop an attitude that says, you know what, I was wrong. I was actually wrong. And so now I will begin to follow Jesus. One other story I just want to show you. Luke chapter 18. Turn to your Bibles, Luke chapter 18. It's actually page 800. Luke chapter 18, page 800 in the Bibles there at your seats. And I want you to just understand how important this attitude of being willing to say I was wrong, how important this attitude is to Jesus. Luke chapter 18, I'm going to begin reading in verse 9 of Luke chapter 18. It says, then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everyone else. In other words, Jesus told this story to people that thought they always were right, that they weren't headed in the wrong direction. They hadn't done anything wrong. They were right instead of I was wrong. That's who Jesus is talking to. So he says, verse 10, two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee. The other was a despised tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer. I thank you, God, that I'm not a sinner like everyone else, for I don't cheat, I don't sin, I don't commit adultery. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give you a tenth of my income. He said, one guy prayed who kept saying, I am right. I am right, I am right, I am right. Second guy prays, verse 13, the tax collector stood in the distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, oh God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner. I was wrong. Jesus says, I tell you this, the sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. And Jesus just says, you know what, of the two? Who is it that I'm here for? Who is it that has best standing with me? It's not the guy that says, I'm right, I'm right, I'm right. Jesus says, it's the one who's willing to say, I'm wrong. I was wrong. You and I, if we would go through this year and begin to use that phrase, I was wrong, I think our lives would be different. Our lives would change. Our relationship with God would change dramatically. Instead of being like the guy that says, I was right, here's all the things that I'm doing right, God, please notice the things I'm doing right. Instead, we step back and say, look, I was wrong, and I'm sorry. I was wrong. Now, because we're wrong, something has to be done about the wrongs in our life. Something has to be done about the wrongs. God calls the wrongs in our lives our imperfections. God calls those things sins. Anything less than perfection is sin. And so when we take a wrong turn and we're heading in the wrong direction, then God just calls that sin. And so something has to be done about that sin. And so God has done this incredible thing. We just celebrated it at Christmas. God himself came into the world, took on himself the form of a human being, a baby first that grows to be a man named Jesus. God himself in the form of a human being. And Jesus did what none of us could do. He lived a perfect life, no wrong turns. Never did he have to say, I was wrong. He lived a perfect life. And because he lived that perfect life, he had opportunity to go back into heaven, but he chose not to go back alone. Instead, Jesus chose to do something for us so that those of us that had made wrong turns could actually spend eternity in heaven in a perfect place. And what Jesus did is he offers an exchange between you and him, exchange between me and him. And what Jesus actually offers with this exchange is he says, look, I will take all of your imperfections, all of your wrong turns, all of my wrong turns. Jesus says, I'll take all of your wrong turns, your imperfections, your sins. He says, I will take those, and in exchange, he says, I will give you all of my perfection. And he offers this incredible exchange, his perfection for our imperfection. And then Jesus goes to the cross, and when he's on the cross, and he's hanging on the cross, he pays the penalty. He pays the sin, the penalty for all of our sin, all of our imperfections, every wrong turn that you make, every wrong turn that I make. Jesus pays the penalty for those sins. Now, when Jesus walked the earth, he knew that he was going to do this. He knew that he was going to make an exchange possible. His perfection for our imperfection. He knew that was going to happen. He knew that he was going to pay the penalty by hanging on a cross. And so Jesus, when he was with his closest followers, said, look, I'm about to do something that I don't ever want you to forget. And so he explained what he was about to do. He said, I'm going to hang on a cross. When I'm on the cross, my blood is going to be shed. And he said, I don't ever want you to forget my blood that's being shed for you. I don't want you to ever forget my body that's going to hang on a cross for you. And so the night before Jesus' death, he actually gave instructions to the people. And he said, I want you from time to time to take bread. And when you eat the bread, I want you to remember my body that's going to hang on a cross for you. And then Jesus said, I want you to take drink. And when you drink it, I want you to remember my blood that's going to be shed for you. He said, it's because of my body that's going to hang on a cross. It's because of my blood that's shed for you that all of your wrong turns can be exchanged for all of my perfection. And Jesus said, I just want you to do this from time to time to remember so you don't ever forget what I'm about to do for you. And so we're going to do that today as we start the new year. We're going to eat the bread, we're going to drink the drink, and remember what Jesus has done for us. And as we eat and as we drink, then I would just encourage you to say, okay, God, thank you. We don't deserve it. It's not something we've earned. But through his grace, through his goodness to us, he offers this incredible exchange, his perfection for our imperfection. And now, before we eat, before we drink, one of the things that God tells us to do is to come clean before him, just to spend a moment and just come clean and say, okay, God, here's what's going on in my life. Before I eat, before I drink, and remember what Jesus has done for me, I just need to come clean and remember what all is going on in my life and say, God, I'm sorry. I was wrong. And so we're going to take just a moment. I'm going to give you opportunity to talk to God and to come clean before him, just to kind of confess. And you know what it is, where you're headed in the wrong direction, what it is that you're doing that you ought not be doing. And so maybe it's just things that are going on in your head, thoughts that you're having that are inappropriate. Maybe it's actions that you're involved in. Maybe it's things that you've said. Maybe it's the way you've treated other people. You know what it is. And so I'm going to give you opportunity, just there in your seats, quietly in your heart, in your head, to talk to God and say, okay, God, just need to say, I was wrong. I was wrong about this. I was wrong about that. What I'm doing right now, I'm wrong. And just confess it to God, and then realize as you confess it to him, he says, I've already paid the penalty for that. I forgive you. As he hangs on the cross for us, he's forgiven each and all of our wrongs. And so take a moment now, and you talk to God. I'll be quiet. And just you there in your seat, you talk to God. Say, okay, God, here's where I was wrong. Father, I think the hardest thing for any of us to do is just to go ahead and admit I was wrong. And as we do that, you forgive us. As we come clean before you, you forgive us and say, you know what? I'll take that. I'll take that wrong. I'll take that sin. I'll take that action. I'll take those words. I'll take those thoughts that were inappropriate. I'll take whatever it is. And in exchange, I'll give you my perfection. What an incredible exchange that you make possible for us. God, how gracious you are. We don't deserve it. And yet the fact that you are willing to come into the world and live a perfect life and exchange your perfection for our imperfection is just incredible. So God, today we say thank you. Thank you for being willing to take on our sins. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for allowing us to live lives that don't have to be full of shame and don't have to be full of guilt. Instead, Father, we can look to you and not have to carry that weight. Instead, we can just carry the weight of your perfection. So, Heavenly Father, today we say thank you for Jesus, and we say thank you for forgiving us, and we love you for it. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen.